What's going on, everybody? I'm Mecca coming at you here from Driven Hard. I am inside my home office, and it's going to be a different video today. This is going to be kind of a conversation, discussion, reaction video to a video that TFL actually just put up on their channel a few days ago. And it's all about the new Defender. And they are on their third Defender. If you're not familiar with the Fastlane car, I'll link in the description. I'll put a link to their channel and this specific video that I'm going to be doing a reaction to. Now, I actually have some history with TFL. Back in May or June of last year of 2019, I was actually on TFL's channel on their episode, you know, like love it or buy it or something like that, when I bought the Driven Hard Range Rover. And so it's really cool. I'll also have a link for that in the description. You can go check that out on their channel. But it was really neat kind of meeting these guys. And, you know, these are the guys that I've been watching for the longest time, you know, like I'm sure a lot of you have as well. So it was kind of neat being at the studio and checking out their place. And I actually got some behind the scenes footage. I had a great discussion with Nathan. But TFL, they are on their third brand new Defender. We're going to run through some of the issues that they ran into. But the main thing that I wanted to do kind of a video on this is the amount of attention that this has brought to the new Defender and to their reliability. And to give the short version of it, everyone's like, oh yeah, this is, you know, the new Defender is unreliable because of this, because of that. We're going to talk about, you're going to see some of the issues that they ran into. And honestly, it breaks down to one thing. It doesn't break down to JLR's reliability issues or really it's not that at all. It was just their bad luck. And unfortunately, TFL, they've been having their fair share of bad luck with cars. I believe they've had issues with their electric BMWs this year. Their Tesla Model 3s, it's been like nothing but problems with that. And they just took a delivery of a Ford Raptor, I believe. But that, I believe, was more on a bad dealership that they dealt with and them buying vehicles without actually taking a look at the vehicle. But they have bought enough vehicles that I don't think they need to be taking a look at it, but they kind of got something, which I do feel is more of a dealership issue than it being, you know, whatever. But bottom line is, the new Defender that they've got, they've ran into a couple issues with it. I'm gonna play this video, they're gonna talk about it. I'm gonna give some of my reactions, some of my thoughts. But there are some points here that I definitely don't agree with. Now, this is my first time watching this as well, so it is gonna be a 100% reaction video. I'll pause it, talk about it, and I'm gonna make this as raw as possible for you. So let's go into it.
Yes, we have had quite the track record with the 2020 Land Rover Defender, and in this video we are going to talk about our experience with our Defender.
In this podcast.
Oh, I'm sorry, yes, I'm so used to saying video. In this podcast we are going to talk about our experience with the new Defender, but if you're watching it on YouTube, you can also see what we're talking about in real time.
Yep.
We're going to do a build and price, talk about the different options available on the Defender, and where we're going to go from here.
That's coming up right now. Sit back and relax, or keep driving if you're driving. TFL Talking Cars is on the air, the world's most popular car podcast. Okay, maybe not yet, but we're working on it.
Good ambitions,
right,
Roman.
I said our third Defender, and I meant our third new Defender, because we're waiting for our third new Defender. But before we tell you how we burned through two Defenders, because that's what happened, basically, let's go back... Oh, I don't know, 4 or 5 months this summer when the Defender was, you know, the hottest, newest, coolest off-roader, and we decided to purchase one because we wanted to test it and do a long-term test on it.
Well, I think we placed our order, I think back in June. Does that sound right?
It sounds, I forget, it's been such a long, 2020, you know, it could be June, it could be July, it was this summer.
No, I'm quite sure it was June, and yeah, basically we wanted it to be pretty early on to the Defender bandwagon. We wanted to see what it was like off-road, but in order to do that, we had to order the right one, because the Defender is a very expensive, very luxurious vehicle, and it's easy to get into a model for $80,000 or $85,000. It's not easy to get into one for $50,000 or $55,000.
Yeah, we came up with an editorial plan, which was to create this video series called The Hell and Back. And the idea was we would drive a Defender from here in Colorado to Moab, take it on Hell's Revenge, which is an iconic off-road trail in Moab, and then drive it back, get it to Hell and Back. And some would argue that that's been our experience, and we'll get into that. But that was the plan. Look, the Defender has been, well, I think the crucible for... the DNA of the Land Rover brand, right? It's when you think about what the Land Rover stands for, right? It stands for a luxurious off-roader. It's just a little bit younger than a Jeep Wrangler, right? It basically came out of that tradition of the Jeeps being in Europe. And for a long time, the Defender was not available in the U.S. It actually only came here for, what, 2 years or something in the 90s?
I think it was 3 years, yeah. Mid-90s, like 94 through, I believe, 97. But keep in mind that back in those days, the Defender was not a luxurious vehicle. It was a proper...
It was a tractor.
It was a short wheelbase, solid axle, off-road beast, basically.
Yeah, but over time, it's developed into this vehicle that, you know, has conquered Africa, and then has become something that is more than just, you know, a tractor, which is the way it started out, right?
I mean, I would argue that Land Rover has evolved far past where the Defender has been historically. So the Defender, even the last one sold in Europe in, like, 2015, 2016, were still very agricultural. But the brand kind of became focused on tackling tough terrain, but with swaths of leather and air suspension. So
off-road luxury.
Yeah, but the Defender was always the off-road DNA of the brand. It had almost no luxury in it. So when Land Rover released the new one, they followed their new route of incorporating luxury into what is, you know, their heritage. And that's kind of what they were going for with the new Defender.
Anyway, we wanted to prove that it was... off-road worthy, that it was rugged, that it was square jawed, all that good stuff, and we're good at doing that here because we've got the Rocky Mountains at our footsteps, at your doorstep, and the idea was to buy one that had everything you need and nothing that you don't need. And the
Okay, before they get into the configuration, that was a really interesting point that I think Tommy brought up there. You know, the Defender was kind of the thing that really got Land Rover going, and at one point, when did they introduce the Range Rover? And that's when they did start shifting into more of an off-road luxurious brand. In fact, I'll link another channel that I've watched, and it's the history of the Range Rover, I believe, that Donut Media has. Phenomenal video on just kind of the history of that particular model and a bit of the brand as well. But that is so true. It's the Defender was kind of the utilitarian, tractor-like, go anywhere, it's going to be rough and tough. Type of vehicle for Land Rover, but as all companies and brands, they evolve. They came out with another product that was still the rough and tough go anywhere, but let's just do it in a whole bunch of leather, make you feel good, look good, while you're climbing over mountains that people wish, you know, they could only dream of going over, which essentially was the Range Rover.
Curator actually lets you do that pretty easily, right? So why don't we talk about how you can configure a Defender?
Well, just like the old model, there are still two configurations. There's the 90, which is the short wheelbase two-door model, and then there's the 110, which is the long wheelbase four-door model. We bought the 110 because the 90 wasn't available.
Yeah, it's not coming out until 2021.
Yeah, it's going to be a wait until we can realistically get our hands on that one. Plus, the new Defender is, you know, not as much of a rock crawler as the old one, and it's built primarily more, at least we think, for crossing big stretches of land off-road. So if you're going to be doing what is now called overlanding, you do want the extra space and the longer wheelbase and the air suspension, and that all is incorporated into the four-door Defender. So it starts at about $50,000. Typically, the ones you see in the lot will be upwards of $70,000 or $75,000, but we custom-ordered one specifically to meet all of our needs. So it was white. You wanted white for some reason.
Well, white was the basic color that you didn't have to pay any extra money for. Remember, the whole idea was everything you need and nothing you don't. So we went with the white vehicle with the white steelies because they come standard.
Yeah, it was just a base Defender, so there's a lot of trim. Defender, Defender S, Defender SE, Defender HSE, Defender X. This was not even the S.
So just the Defender.
Total, as we call it, bean can. It didn't have the premium LED lights. It didn't have the upgraded wheels, so you can get 18-inch 5-spoke wheels, or you can go to 19s or 20s, or kind of the sky's the limit there. We didn't even get the contrasting roof because that was an extra cost. But we did go for, on the inside, the 6-seater configuration.
Yeah, because we thought that was utilitarian and cool, right? So instead of having a console in the middle, there's a seat that kind of folds down and you can fold
that jump seat is super cool.
Because the seat is so tall, you lose the ability to look out your rearview mirror, and so then automatically you get the camera, the rear-facing camera, right, that turns into a camera and a video feed when you look into the mirror. And you had to get that came as
well. Yeah, it's like a package deal kind of thing.
And then we didn't get any of like the sunroof, heated seats, basic seats. We didn't even have like electric seats, right? These were just basic.
I think they were called the eight-way seats.
Eight-way seats, yeah. No lumbar. And the coolest thing about it was we didn't have digital instrumentation, right? They were still standard instruments in the cluster.
Oh, that is so cool.
The full digital screens.
So it was really basic.
We didn't even, like, let me clarify this. We didn't even have fog lights.
No.
But the thing is, and this is where it's pretty astounding, it was still a $55,000 vehicle.
Well, that's because we got the locking rear diff.
Yeah, so if we dive into the options here, if you're watching on YouTube, we got the advanced off-road capability package, which gives you a separate terrain mode, basically in auto mode. It also gives you off-road cruise control, as I like to call it, but advanced all-terrain progress control. And then we also got the, what is it called? I want to get the name right. It's the electronic active differential.
Here's the important part. In the UK, in Europe, you've got a lot of different power plant options. In America, we have two, right? So we don't get the diesel, which, by the way, might be coming, but it's not here. So we don't get the diesel options. We only get the Ingenium 4-cylinder turbo and the 6-cylinder turbo. So those are the only two options. The base engine is the 4-cylinder. And when you're off-roading, you don't need a lot of power. The 2-liter puts out, and this is going to be important as the story develops, so just a little foreshadowing, puts out 300 horsepower, which isn't a lot out of a 2-liter, especially when you're, you know, at, let's say, 2 miles above sea level.
Okay, so here's my first thing I just want to talk about. And I, like, I'm no expert, but what do you guys think? The Land Rover's 4-cylinder engines, I've heard nothing but horror stories from. When I was down in Mexico, speaking to the mechanics down there, it was just a problematic engine. That little 2-liter 4-cylinder turbocharged engine was just problematic, whether it be the turbos or other components in it. And especially in something like the Defender, you know, I get it. In Evoque, Discovery Sport, whatever, it's a small, tiny little vehicle. Yeah, sure, putt around town in a 4-cylinder. But a Defender, it's a lot heavier, it's bigger, and to go off-roading, do you really want a 4-cylinder having to work with all of that weight? I'd love to know what your guys' thoughts are in the comments about that little engine.
Out of a little 2-liter turbo, that's a lot of compression that you're putting through the engine, we figure.
I kind of think that 300 horsepower with 2 liters is insane.
Yeah.
That's a huge amount of power to speak.
Okay, 300 horsepower out of a 4-cylinder is not insane. It's common in 2020, Tommy. You need to, like, that was insane back when I was in high school. Yeah, I remember the Honda Prelude, little 4-cylinder engine putting out just over 200 horsepower back in the day. High school, that was like 15 years ago or whatever, right? But lots of 4-cylinders are putting out over 300 horsepower now. That's kind of, you know, it might be on the higher end of stuff, but it's not insane by any means with where technology is. What's insane is having the stress and everything off-roading with such a small engine and all that weight.
Small of a displacement engine. The only one we could come up with was the XC90, right?
So I strongly believe that 300 horsepower is like way more than you ever need in a vehicle like this.
Especially off-road.
Yeah, the horsepower is not the issue. I think, like you said, the issue is the fact that it's 300 horsepower from a really small engine in terms of capacity.
And this decision becomes, I think, crucial to why we're on a third Defender as we tell the story. So anyway, we got the base engine. We got everything you need, nothing you don't to go off-road. Well,
look at this, though. I mean, I'm on the configurator.
Yeah.
If you look at the Defender, starting 50,500 for the 4-cylinder, to jump up to the straight 6, base MSRP 62. It's a $12,000 difference if you want to jump up to the 6-cylinder. And you get a bunch of different things with the 6-cylinder, like they make you get bigger wheels,
right?
Because you can't fit the cool steelies under it.
Yeah, we wanted the steelies, too, so you can't. With the steelies, you get smaller brakes with a smaller engine, so you can put steelies on it.
We really wanted to keep the price down.
Yeah, we did.
Because it's not realistic. First of all, $55,000 is still not priced down, but it's not realistic to buy a $70,000, $75,000 off-roader. Like, this is not going
to
happen in the real world.
We wanted to compare it to a Wrangler and a 4Runner, and both of those are in the $50,000 range.
Potentially.
Now, the 4Runner, the Wrangler certainly can be.
Yeah, it can be. So anyway, we ordered this vehicle specifically in June. And then we had to wait because they're built in, I think, Slovakia. Is that right?
They're built in Slovakia. It's a brand new plant. They just built it. And ironically, the one thing we didn't get, the option, which you think we get, are the off-road tires. And that's because even the most off-road tires that you can get on a Defender from the factory aren't really that off-roady. We want
probably just Wranglers.
Twos,
yeah. KM3s.
Something like that. Not, you know, just kind of more rugged, basic kind of street tires that have a little bit bigger. You know, we wanted serious off-road tires because we were going to take it to some serious off-road.
So we placed the order in June, and we didn't really hear anything for a number of months. So it's kind of radio silence. We knew that We had the order in the system, but we really had no idea about delivery date. They were suspecting October is what we were told back in the summer. And it turns out they were actually spot on. So it turned up at the beginning of October to our dealership here in Broomfield, Colorado.
Yep. We had it sent to a local dealer, which is close to us. And we were super excited, you know. We went and actually saw it before they even called us because, dealerships here are closed on Sunday, and we were driving by the dealership because it's on the way to the airport, and I saw a white Defender there. I'm like, I wonder if that's ours with white skis, and sure enough, it was. So, you know, we were super excited. We went to pick it up. We cut them a check for $55,000 plus tax, and right away we did a video because they had a Defender X comparing, like, the cheapest to the most expensive. Remember that?
This is an $85,000 rig. That's right. The one they had on the lot. And there are a ton of differences. I mean, everything from fog lights to the, the instrument cluster was different. That one had all sorts of crazy options in the back with the trunk. I mean, the air compressor was optional as well. There's just, I priced one out, and I think the highest I could get it was just over $100,000. Was the most expensive.
And we actually had tried to get, I think it's called the Adventure Package on ours, but it was back ordered.
Explorer Package.
Explorer.
So that was the snorkel, the roof rack.
Yeah.
I think the box on the side, maybe the ladder was part of the Explorer.
So we ordered that because we figured that's a very off-roady package. When the vehicle arrived, and keep in mind we ordered this not through the dealer, but through JLR, because of this podcast and because of our YouTube channel. You know, we're automotive journalists, so we have access to corporate. So we ordered it through JLR.
That's definitely kind of cool. I didn't know they were able to do stuff like that. Not go through dealers, and you order directly from the company. That's kind of cool. A little journalistic benefit there, right? That's neat.
And a discount, though. We paid just like anyone else would pay. I mean, we didn't pay over sticker, but we certainly...
I think you're right, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, there was no discount.
There was no discount on the vehicle.
I think there may have been a $1,000 discount.
But I think there was a rebate on all
rebate.
The Defenders.
Yeah. Yeah, but there was no, like, special...
No, they weren't like, well...
They did put our order in quickly, so it helped.
That's true.
Anyway, and then the other special treatment we got is we got a call saying, hey, the thing's at the... port, but all this stuff you want for the package is backordered, and so we said, you know, forget about it. We'll just take the vehicle as is because at this point, you know, we want to start doing videos. Because look, in our business, being one of the first to do the Defender review off road is important because it's a competitive business. And after a while, when people do them, then people move on to other vehicles. So we did this first video, and then immediately the next day, we took it up Webster Pass.
Yeah, it's pretty mild. So brand new vehicle, we weren't going to push it to the limit. Day two, we just wanted to. Do a cool video showing some of the Colorado scenery. Webster Pass is a trail that kind of winds its way up through the Rocky Mountains to, I think, 11 or 12,000 feet above sea level. Nothing too insane. You know, I don't think we ever bottomed out of the vehicle. We never got it stuck.
That video's on TFL Off-Road. And the other reason we took it off-road immediately is, well, because in the winter, we get tons of snow. It's the Colorado Rockies, and once it snows, all the off-roading closes for the whole winter. Basically, it gets too deep and too steep and too dangerous to go off-road.
And the vehicle performed great off-road.
Yeah.
I mean, it had no issues.
Until.
It didn't struggle. I mean, at no point off-road did we... Did we have any issues? Then we drove. Hang on, I'm going way basic here.
Right.
We drove it all the way up to the top of the mountain,
yeah.
Which was over 12,000 feet above sea level. We turned around, drove it way back, switched back to the little river crossing, brought it back on the pavement, drove it down the pavement for I think 3 or 4 miles, and then we got the check engine light.
Yeah, right in the parking lot of the Keystone Ski Area, we got the check engine light. I think we had gone and gotten a pizza or something. Right, it was a late lunch, and then like, oh, that's not good. And so, you know, we're like, oh wow, 167 miles is what it had, and we drove it straight back to the dealership the next day, I believe.
Yep.
It was a Friday.
And it didn't have any difficulty driving
no.
the 80-some miles back to the dealer. So it didn't stumble, it didn't hesitate, it just had this error code.
But when we brought it here to our offices, before we took it to the dealership, we did run a scan tool on it, because we have those here. And what did the tool say?
It was showing a misfire in, I think, cylinders 2 and 3. So it was, it was showing a misfire in cylinders 2 and 3. But that's pretty much all we could get out of our basic scan tool. We don't have the same capability that a Land Rover facility has. So we drove it. To the dealership, which is, you know, 15 miles
down. So my first question on that, and once again, if you know this, hit me up in the comments. If you're misfiring on cylinders, and in my experience, when my car's, you know, I'm thinking back to my Mazda when it was misfiring, or my Integra, you know it's misfiring. It's not driving normally all of a sudden. And with modern vehicles, I would assume it's the same. I'd assume you'd hear it, especially in a little four banger, you'd hear it. And they said they drove about 80 miles, right? So if it was actually misfiring, wouldn't you feel it? Or wouldn't you be feeling that? So if anything, it was probably the sensor, but I don't think we're ever going to find out.
On the road.
Oh, it's like a few minutes.
Yeah, dropped it off at them.
Yeah.
And said, you know, please take a look at this.
Yeah, so they took it. They said we fixed it. Come pick it up. So we were out of town. I think it was like Monday. They called us. They said it was fixed. So Andre went and picked it up on either Monday or Tuesday. He got it back to the offices, and he was backing it up, and he noticed that the backup camera wasn't working.
And the fix for the check engine light was a PCM update. It was a software update.
Software patch, yeah.
Yeah, for the computer.
And the cool thing about the Defender is it's got this really cool camera system where it gives you not only a 360-degree view of the vehicle, but you can actually see through the hood, and you can see as if you were, like, standing next to the vehicle or behind it. So it's really...
Camera system's absolutely insane.
You can spin the vehicle around. Almost looks like a movie when you're watching.
Like, it's so cool.
It's a really cool feature. That didn't work. It just said, I think the message was, like, camera's not available.
And that was literally when Andre got back to the office and started picking up for the dealer. Yeah. So he turned back around and drove right back to the dealer and said, hey, you know, just picked up this car for the check engine light fix. Now the cameras aren't working. Do you mind taking a look at it?
And that was the last time we saw it.
Yeah, it was.
That was the last time we drove it.
That was, I think, a month and a half ago.
That was about six weeks ago.
Because,
in October.
So initially, the issue that was causing that camera problem was a module that was backward. So they had to wait for the module to come in.
Yeah.
And while they were waiting for the module to come in, the check engine light came back on. And they were actually eventually able to replace that module, get all the cameras working. But that check engine light was a killer because it was still showing misfire codes. Basically, they were saying it was, quote, operating outside of its parameters.
And I have to say, DLR was wonderful. They gave us updates every day, you know, either from the dealership or from corporate. They called me, you know, every afternoon, and it became this kind of running joke where the guy would call me and be like, yep, still broken.
Keep in mind, so at this point, it had left the local dealership.
Yeah, they told me that they got a hold of a JLR engineer who came in and was going to actually try to diagnose the problem, who actually got in touch with the engineers back in the UK. And so they took it to a JLR facility in Denver, away from the dealership, where they were going to try to figure out, you know, why he kept throwing this check engine light.
Right, and that was a long process, so I think that's what's taken the majority of the time.
That took like a month.
It did, and they looked at, I mean, they looked at pretty much everything related to the engine, everything related to ignition, spark plugs, coils.
What they told me, and you know, at this point now I'm just repeating what I was told by both the dealership and the PR team at JLR, and that is, you know, they went through it and they did the typical things that you would do to figure out what's wrong with an engine. So first, of course, you find out if it's getting fuel, right? Then you find out if it's getting the right amount of air, then you find out if it's getting spark, and then you look at the compression. I mean, that's really what an internal combustion engine needs.
And they said all that was operating properly.
And it was still throwing it.
Yeah, I mean, and the funny thing too is, like, typically, the great thing about modern vehicles is that they have these diagnostic tools. So there's so many sensors that, unlike an old vehicle where you have to go through, you have to mechanically go through every component on the engine to figure out what's going on. The idea with the new system is you just plug in a dongle into the vehicle and be like, oh, you know, it needs an O2 sensor, or oh, there's an issue with the charging system. But apparently, on our Defender, it was just saying misfire. Right? It was just saying...
Well, they said that they couldn't diagnose it and that it was working. This is, once again, I don't know. You know, I didn't see it. I wasn't there with the engineer or the mechanics. But what I was told with the vehicle was that it was operating outside of its normal operating parameters, that means.
Which is an awesome way of saying that something is gone
wrong. And there's something that's wrong deep down in the engine.
I like this comment, and I think I'm going to use this too, but someone said that they're going to use that to describe 2020. You know, it's operating outside of its set parameters.
Yeah, so something deep in the engine, that's, you know, and if you're wondering what that is, I don't know. And they wanted to stress to me that they could certainly fix it. It was just going to be a matter of time. They said, we'll do whatever you want, basically. So we had three choices at that moment, right? First, they suggested that if we want, they'll get us a new engine.
Well, that's what they said it would come down to, is replacing the 2-liter turbo in the vehicle. So what they said is they could have and this was back, you know, earlier this month. Yeah. They could have an engine at ports by the middle of November.
It would have to come from Europe.
Yep, and then it would take a couple of weeks to
get it through customs and all that.
Yeah, and then they could probably have it here, stateside, sometime around November 30th.
Well, yeah, or maybe, you know, installed by November 30th. Anyway, it didn't matter. Look, when you buy a new car, you want that factory fresh seal, right? And so the idea of a dealership learning how to install an entire new engine, I'm sure that the dealership could do it, but it just didn't fill me with glee, right? That's why you're buying a new car, right? You don't want a second engine in the thing.
Yeah.
And that was
bits and pieces.
Even though I did appreciate the offer. The other option we could have had is we could have gotten our money back. They would have bought the vehicle back. And a lot of people in the comments for our videos are saying you should lemon law it. And the lemon law here is it has to be in the dealer for how long? It's like 30 days, I think.
Yeah, 30.
At that point, it was.
30 days.
But it wouldn't have gotten to that, right? They weren't arguing about the fact that this was not a fix, right? They were like, hey, we want to make sure you understand we can fix this, but, you know, because this has been such a painful process, we'll be happy to give you your money back. Or the third option was to get a different car. And, you know, we're not like typical Land Rover, Range Rover buyers, right? We don't buy this because we're going to drive it to work and have it be our car. We buy it because we review it. And we have a whole fleet of cars here, so it's our job to review cars. But because we have a whole fleet of cars, we don't depend on it, right? We can use other vehicles. And since it is our job, like I said, to review cars, we want to review it. This was still one of the most exciting, one of the most highly anticipated new vehicles of the year. And so we said, you know, let's replace it. And they sent us a choice of two different ones.
They did, yeah. And they were both four-cylinders, both four-doors, spec totally different fleet than ours. So, I mean, we could have gone through the process of ordering a brand new one and waiting. for them to build another one exactly what we wanted.
Yeah.
But that would have been a matter of months.
But that would have been another 3 or 4 months before we got it. And at that point, the Bronco was going to be out, and you know, people would have moved on. And so a lot of the comments in the YouTube videos are like, well, you should have, you know, had to build you the spec you wanted. And by that point, the video series would have been dead, right? You got to
strike. Yeah, there's not as much interest.
There's not as much interest, and you guys have moved on to the Jeep 392 or the Ford Bronco Sport or the Ford Bronco or the Rivian. You know, there's a lot of other vehicles that are coming down the pike. So we said no. And the difference between the two was one was white, one was blue. They didn't have the blocking differential.
I don't think they had any of the optional off-road equipment. So all defenders have terrain response, all defenders have a low range and four-wheel drive and that kind of stuff. And they actually all have air suspension in the U.S. as well, the 110s. But it didn't have the active locking diff, it didn't have the terrain response too, but we're like, that's okay.
We'll just make it work.
And they were like 56 and 57,000.
So basically, instead of the off-road stuff, they had like the luxury stuff. So
well, they had like, yeah, heated seats, heated steering wheel, alloy wheels. Yeah.
And then one was white and one was blue. And we decided to go with the blue one because it was here in Denver for a simple reason, is that we wanted to draw a clear and concise delineation between the one that was delivered first and broken to the new one. So I didn't want people mistaking and somehow thinking that somehow the, you know, the one that we ordered originally was the same one that we actually replaced it with. So
actually,
that's why I went with the blue one.
If you're watching on YouTube, I will show you what that one looked like. So yeah. It was a Defender 110. Look at the trims here. So there's S-E-X, you know, for like, yeah. It was an S.
Yeah, and they delivered it to our dealership. And actually, Tommy and I, this was like 2 weeks ago, we're driving once again to a program to the airport, and we drove by on a Sunday to go out to the airport, and we saw a blue one sitting at the airport at the dealership, and I'm like, hey, I wonder if that's ours. And so we pulled in, and sure enough, that was ours. And we were super excited because it was really cool.
So it was Tasman blue.
Yeah.
And then it also had the acorn grained leather and then woven material interior. Yeah. And so it's an S, which means the S trim.
Yeah.
Gives you it gives you automatic high beams.
Right.
It gives you premium gauges, so you get the full digital gauges.
Right.
Standard alloy wheels.
Yeah.
It gives you a couple other little things here and there. And then this one also had the heated seats. It gave you the 12-way power seats.
The throwing in the window was nice.
Yeah, it gave you, I think it heated steering wheel too, was another option on this one.
Anyway, so we were super excited, and I'm thinking to myself, this was 2 weeks ago, hey, we'll have it, you know, when we come back from our trip to Charlotte where we were reviewing the new Durango Hellcat. And then I get a call from JLR, and when I had initially started this series, I had requested a winch because we wanted the most off-road worthy one there was, and they were backordered. And winches for these, factory winches are expensive. It's a $6,000 option, which is...
Six G's? Good God.
Got you that winch you wanted, and I was like, terrific, we got a new car and we got a winch, and they're like, but we have to have the dealership put it on, so you know, hold up a few days and we'll have the dealer put it on and you can go pick it up. Oh, like, great, look at that, it's a win-win. We finally get to make the video series. You know, we've been telling the story, now we're gonna get to make my plan, Tommy, for that next video when we went picking up, I had this whole plan in my head. I was like, we were gonna be driving in the vehicle filming, right? And we were going to be talking about, we got a Defender back, and then you were going to say, hey, this one has a white interior. Didn't our old one have? And then, you know, we go outside and surprise our viewers with the fact that we got a new one. Well, that's late plans of mice and men often go astray.
We were told that the first winch was defective and wasn't working.
Yeah, so you know, this is like Monday now. By Friday, no car. I get a phone call, and they're like, hey, the winch that we put in isn't working. We've ordered you another one. It has to come down from Canada, so it's going to take a couple days. We found one. I think it was in Toronto. I'm like, okay, all right. Now it's taking longer than I thought. Now we're like into week 5 of not having a vehicle.
Yeah.
I'm like, great, but you know, you feel grateful and you feel appreciative that they actually are going to all this trouble to find you a winch, right? And so I'm like, great, put it on. So wait. Another week goes by, and then I get the call that was quite shocking. What happened?
Well, they said that they cut through during the install of the winch.
It was the second winch.
The second winch, yes, they cut through wiring harness,
yes,
or a wiring loop, and that the vehicle was undeliverable.
And the boom was unreplaceable.
Unreplaceable. So,
yes, that's, once again, this is what, you know, we were told.
So this is a very interesting thing. Now, I have done a winch install on a Wrangler before.
Yeah.
And if you do it on, like, a Wrangler, it's very simple, because the bumper sticks out 3 feet behind the vehicle, pop it in there, wire to the battery, bam, you're good. The Defender winch requires you to take up the whole front end of the vehicle.
Yeah, because it incorporates
into
the nose, right?
It's so a completely different type of vehicle.
Now, they did not elaborate further on what the wiring harness they cut through did or was. And there's been a lot of discussion in the comment section on what that means. And there's even been some discussion on, you know, was it a wiring harness issue or was it another problem that wasn't disclosed to us? What's your thought on that?
I don't know. Wasn't one of the off-road guys in Australia just posted a video regarding our...
So, yeah, there's a bunch of...
No,
so
that
couple
idiot.
Of things going on. There's a YouTube channel called Powerful UK LTE.
Yeah.
And they just did a winch install on their new Defender.
Right.
And they did this big, long series. And I haven't seen all of it. But from what I've been reading in the comments, it doesn't seem like there's a whole ton to really cut through back there. It seems like it's a pretty cut-and-dry install. But, you know, these are complicated vehicles. There's a lot to them. There's a lot of...
Well, you know,
with
the Wrangler, right, the way that the Jeep winch works is you... basically wire to the battery, right, and then you have a remote control that controls.
I mean, as far as I know, that's pretty much how every winch works. So,
but,
like,
but maybe there's a hard control in the defender,
which is a little weird to me. But
we don't know.
It could be. Yeah, it could be. So
but it's an overly complicated vehicle, anyways, so it would make sense.
And you gotta go boop. And that's typically through a you've got a hole in the dashboard, you put it in the toggle. But a winch is typically just a device that connects to the positive and the negative terminals of the battery. You plug in either a remote receiver, if you have a wireless winch, or a wired controller.
I'll leave it up to you guys to speculate.
Right.
We don't know. I'm going to take JLR at their word. They've been excellent. They've been
I agree. Yeah, they've been very good.
And so, basically, that meant that Defender was now not deliverable. And so now, we were working with them to get our third Defender, and they've sent me pictures and options for two of them, a white four-cylinder and a blue six-cylinder. And I'm going to spill the beans right here for the first time. I've decided to go with the six-cylinder Tommy.
Why is that?
Yeah.
Well, it goes back to the start of this conversation, you know.
PTSD with the four-cylinder.
A two-cylinder turbo has enough ohm.
Yeah.
A two-liter four-cylinder turbo has enough ohm, especially at 2 miles above sea level, to move a car as hefty as, I want to say it weighs, what, 6,500 pounds?
I don't know, it's very heavy.
It qualifies for the tax. Yeah,
I mean, the GVW is over 6,000 pounds.
Yeah,
so
maybe 5,500 pounds.
I think, it's like over 8, depending on the configuration.
I just think maybe at sea level it's fine, but when you mix it with lack of oxygen, which at 2 miles above sea level, you're like 30% down on the amount of air density, it really probably strains that little turbo. So I wanted something a little bit more heft, a little bit more punch.
Now, I actually did know that you were leaning toward the 6, and we had a big, long argument about it, because I really want to stick with the original video plan and go with the 4. I think the 6 is a lot more expensive than the 4. I mean, we're going to have to dig deep into our pockets for that one.
Yeah, I emailed them, and I said, we'll pay the difference, but maybe they'll come back to us, and they'll say, you don't have to pay the difference. I don't know. It's really,
And I get Roman, he's just such a stand-up guy, and that's one of the reasons I enjoy watching them, but with everything they've gone through, and once again, maybe his reasoning behind paying the difference. Like, I would not. I'd say, no, you guys, it's like, we've gone through this, we've gone through that. You know, the amount of cars that these guys actually sell for JLR, based on people watching the videos and, you know, it helps solidify my decision to go with the Ranger or after watching all their vehicles, especially the one Roman did on the launch in 2013 with the full-size Range Rover. I wouldn't offer... I mean, I'm just a prick. I wouldn't offer to pay for it, but obviously stand-up guy. But, you know, in all, JLR said, oh, no, we'll just give it to you. You don't have to pay the difference.
And that would be a nice gesture after, you know, everything that we went through, but I don't want to, you know, part of me would appreciate that, and I would expect that if I were a typical consumer to do, but part of me also is like...
And you guys might be wondering, hey, how would a regular customer be treated? And you know what? I've dealt with Land Rover North America a couple times already. Yeah, twice. And they have taken care of me so well. One time the Ranger was down in the shop for a month and a bit down in Mexico. And so I was out of country, out of where my warranty was valid. So I had to deal with head office in order to get replacement parts and compensated for it. And they compensated for everything, for my rental, for hotels. They paid for all the, paid me back for all the work that the dealership had to do. I just paid out of pocket. They sent me a full check back. But they were more than helpful and more like, you know, phenomenal experience working with them. So yeah, if something like this does happen with a regular customer, the dealership might be a little different because that's dealerships and dealerships are run, you know, they're dealerships, they're people there, right? But as far as head office goes, they've been great. And then a couple weeks ago, Range Rover, because of the tune, I had an issue at the dealership and they actually had to rewrite some code because one of the modules basically just bricked itself and the UK had to get involved, rewrite some code. And Jaguar Land Rover, yeah, they said, you know what, we'll just do this whole thing for him out of goodwill and not charge them out of pocket, because technically what they were going to do, the warranty was not going to cover anymore. So thank you, Land Rover.
Like, you know, we put up with a lot of pain in this process that I think most consumers would probably not put up with, right? And let's face it, they could have given us a loaner car. We turned that down, right? Because we don't need a loaner car. I mean, I've got a garage full of vehicles. So I think if you were a regular consumer, you know, we are now going on week 7 after we paid, you know, a substantial amount of money with no vehicle in our garage. But we could have had a loaner, but that's not, you know, that's not what this is about. We look at these cars as kind of movie stars in a movie. And so, you know, at the end of the day, we wanted to skew the video series and show you guys that this thing is actually either good or bad off-road. Go to hell and back and test the vehicle and start making videos. That's our business.
I'm still pushing for the 4. Because I've seen the pictures of the 6. I think it's at a dealer in the West Coast.
Yeah, it's coming from, I think, Oregon or someplace.
Or Washington or something, yeah. And, you know, it's a cool rig, but it's...
And the other problem is the 4-cylinder is white. So they give us 2 options, and I don't want the white one.
I thought it was blue. I thought it was blue as well. I think they were both blue. Yeah, I think they were both Tesla blue. But, well, okay. So one of the issues with... So the 4-cylinder, I think one of the issues was, is it's still in transit. It hasn't showed up at a dealer. So that would, I think, be along the way, what it was sounding like. The 6-cylinder is actually at a dealer, and I think they could ship it to us. But the 6-cylinder has 20-inch wheels. You know, it's,
yeah, it won't be able to steal. It'll be very different from what we started out to do.
I think the other one has like the cool steel wheels. I mean, I'm really still pushing for the cheap, even more affordable one.
Well, you know, nothing preventing you from going to JLR and buying that first one that we
to fix it. I'm not going to buy one. I can't afford a $55,000 rig.
I'm sure that's still out there somewhere, that guy.
But so I don't think either of them have. I think the good news about the 6 is I think it does have the advanced off-road capability group, but it doesn't have the rear diff lock. And even though it has a 20-inch wheel, it's got the off-road tire.
The fact that the one that they got doesn't have a rear diff lock. I was so mad at the latest video that they did. I'm like, how did you guys just accept that? If you wanted to do the whole off-road series and everything, now you're driving around in the bloody Defender with only a center diff lock, not a rear diff lock. Like, that's irritating. And I get they just didn't want to wait, and I totally get where they're coming from in terms of they need to get this video series in order to still be relevant. But, oh my God, I was kind of disappointed, because every video they film off-road with it now, you're going to know, well, okay, how much would that rear diff actually do in terms of a difference? Yeah.
Majority of them I've seen are the 6-cylinder, but I like having the one that's a little bit different. But it's your call at the end of the day.
Yeah, you know, my call is let's get this video series going. I feel, you know, look, this video series I'm sure has not helped JLR sell more Defenders, and our business is not to, you know, help sell or not help sell Defenders. Our business is to create interesting, engaging videos that then let you decide, right? And so from our point of view, it is doing that. It's creating interesting video series, but. As someone who has, we've owned now 2 other Land Rovers, right? We've owned a Disco 2 and an LR3. And you know, the brand, of course, has a reputation for not having the most seller reliability. But yet, the ones that we've owned have been dead reliable, given that they were, you know.
Well, except for the Defender, but.
Well, except for the Defender. But the Disco 2, which is notoriously bad, was good.
Yep.
And the LR3 was absolutely bulletproof. And I love the brand. I love the vehicle. For the short, for the 1.5 day I spent in the Defender, I absolutely fell in love with it. I think, you know, the design is really cool. It's kind of got the.
I want to go off roading.
Big crossovers, RCVs like that, right, are fat and wide and tall. This one is narrow and long, which is, I think, really cool. I think, you know, the designers did a really good job in kind of capturing the original character of the original Defender. Like, those rear taillights are really cool. The materials in the thing are super cool, right? It's got this kind of like almost neoprene like material in place. It's got like exposed screws and rivet heads to show you that it's meant to be rugged. It's got a huge shelf in the front. It's just a really cool vehicle.
I like
those Alpine lights are cool, those little Alpine windows.
I like the interior.
Yep.
The interior's great. It's not a Defender, it's a Discovery. It's massive. The thing you said about being long and narrow, it's so wide, and it's so
it's
tall.
It's not that wide, it's long.
It's super wide.
It's not that wide.
It feels like when you're behind the wheel of it.
It's long, and it's tall, but it's not wide.
It's pretty wide, Dad. I don't know the exact width, but...
Okay, look it up, compare it to, like, compare it to, like, an LX.
Okay.
Right? Like a Lexus LX.
It's a...
Or a Land Cruiser.
It feels bigger than the LR3. I mean, it's just, it's huge.
Or compare it to a Land Cruiser. And by the way, you know, we've taken pretty much every off-road vehicle you can take off-road in the last 10 years. So, you name it, we've taken it. And not on a dirt road, but we've actually, like, rock crawled with it. We've taken it into the sand. We've done some really cool stuff. And by far, the most, and this includes trucks, Tommy, even off-road trucks. And we've had lifted Jeeps, we have lifted trucks, we've done, you know, pretty much everything can do that's possibly to do.
Right. I got it here.
All right, hold on, before I get there, let me make this point, right? And by far, the best ride off-road was the LR3. By far.
No, for sure.
By far. Because it's got air suspension, and the air suspension is just like floating on, well, air. And, you know, it's fun to go off-road for an hour, but when you're, like, doing, let's say, the White Room Trail, which we did with the LR3, which is 120 miles off-road, it gets really old when your head is like flopping back and forth for, you know, 8 hours at a time. And so to have a car or a truck that just smooths out that ride is incredible. And the LR3 was by far the best vehicle we've ever had. And I'm including the Raptor in that, I'm including the TRX, I'm including, you know, our lifted F-250 with the Harley $10,000 off-road suspension, which is, you know, exceptional with King shocks. All that, the LR3 was still by far the smoothest.
So let's play a game. Is the Defender wider or narrower than an LR3?
What do you guys think? Comments. Is the Defender wider or narrower than the LR3? You know what? LR3, old vehicle. Defender, brand new vehicle. Vehicles do tend to get bigger over time, so I'm going with wider. Boom!
Ford is wider than LR3.
Okay.
Is it narrower or wider than a Lexus GX?
No, Lexuses are big vehicles. Narrow. Narrower.
Okay, with that smile on your face, I know it's wider.
It's 5 inches wider than GX.
How much
wider? It's wider than Land Cruiser.
Really? I thought it was narrower.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just a design.
The design is good, but it's too big. It really is
too big. I don't think so. Then you get the 90.
Curb weight, okay. 4,800 to 5,200, according to Google here. Yeah, the Defender 90 will be a little bit smaller.
Yeah, get the smaller one.
This is what the Discovery 5 should have been.
Look, this is somebody who thinks that the ideal car, best car ever made, is the original Mini. So keep that in mind, okay?
Oh, burn!
The size is a detriment when you get it off.
Sure, coming from an original Mini.
First of all, my original Mini.
Oh, money, Roman.
It's a detriment, and the weight's a detriment off-road.
Well, compared to the F-250.
Well, the F-250.
Or compared to a Raptor.
I hate off-roading Raptors.
How much? What,
they don't fit through anything.
Right.
I want to see what a Raptor's. How wide? How much less is it than a Raptor in terms of width? You can play that game now. Is it wider or narrower than a Raptor?
First of all, if it's wider than a Raptor, it's probably going to be illegal to drive on the road.
So let's see how much narrower it is than a Raptor. I'm curious.
This is not helpful here. Google is failing me here.
Yeah, the width, Raptor width.
It's giving me like a bunch of different numbers.
Okay.
Overall width. It's narrower than a Raptor.
Okay, by how much? I'm going to say at least 6 inches.
Yeah, about 6 inches it looks like. But the Raptor doesn't fit through anything. You can't park that in a garage. You can't park that on the street. You can't park that. You can't drive it through a car wash.
I actually don't have a problem with the vehicle size.
I hate driving big vehicles off-road. They just don't fit. And maybe if you live in like...
Once again, this is coming from whose first Jeep was a YJ.
It was
two-door.
The perfect size. The YJ was perfect size. But the point is, if you live in Australia and you have wide open expanses, you're wide as a freeway. But we don't. We have trees. And watching... So we just took the TRX, the Raptor, and the Gladiator off-road.
Yeah.
And I was in the Jeep because...
Well, you're a Jeep guy.
Well, I didn't want to deal with it. And watching
you're Jeep guy.
Was ridiculous. They just, they're cheap. They did too much. They did it, but you were like, oh, I gotta watch my $80,000 side here. But the little Gladiator just goes whoop, 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 and the Gladiator's even too big.
Yeah,
that thing's
huge too.
That thing is huge too, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm on the fence about the Defender, but.
Anyway, my point is, I really love the car. I think it's way cool. I think they did a bang-up job in terms of actually making it, look, for a long time, like G-Wagons were designed and are designed to be extremely off-road capable, but nobody takes them off-road because, well, they all take them down Hollywood Boulevard. And I think Land Rover did a great job in fighting against that, right? So the packages you can get for it, the features, right? In a Range Rover with 22s, taking it off-road just seems absolutely silly. I know you can and it will do it, but it's just not, it's just, it's like, I don't know, it's like wearing workout clothes to, you know, right? You can do it, but who'd want to do that? Whereas with this, it actually feels like it belongs off-road, and I think that is a testament to, you know, the design and then all the ability they gave it, and that's why we wanted to test it.
But why is it feeling? I mean, it really, the suspension is pretty similar to the Discovery.
Okay, and this is one of the biggest things, and this is where, if you have not taken the new Defender out for a test drive, go do it, like, right away. Because as soon as you do, and if you've driven Range Rovers or the current Disco, you're going to see instantly why the Defender makes sense for today's Land Rover lineup. When you're driving it, it just feels like it wants to be off-road. Everything about it is just squared off. Like I said on my Instagram, the new Defender is basically like a luxurious or upscale Wrangler. Like, it drives the same way, it's squared, you're sitting in there squared, you have those big, you know, the black things on the hood. It just reminds me so much of what driving a Wrangler is like. It just feels like you want to hop the curb. It just feels like it wants to be off-road. Whereas driving around my Range Rover, it does not feel like that at all. Like, it doesn't at all. but you know it can, and you know it can keep up with the best, and it does it without breaking a sweat. But the defender does feel like a true off-roader for today's Land Rover lineup. Not comparing it to the past, because that's irrelevant, because it's 2021, we're not comparing things to the past anymore. That doesn't make any sense or do any good. And that was the biggest thing that blew me away, was just how different it drove compared to the rest of the current lineup.
I just have a hard time understanding why this is better off-road than, like,
a snorkel.
And that's another thing. And that's why I've been trying to connect with somebody who owns a Defender locally, so we can go and do a couple off-road trails with their Defender in my Range Rover, and we can actually see, compare apples to apples, which one is actually better off-road, which one does the same test with more ease or struggles a bit more, because that's one thing I haven't seen any videos on yet. If you know a video, let me know. But I haven't seen anyone actually compare the new Defender to the current Discovery, to the current Range Rover Sport. And those are the videos I want to see, because hell, for 90 grand, I ain't buying a Defender. Pfft, hell no, I'm gonna buy a Range Rover. It just makes way more sense. But for my, you know, I guess for what I want, Defender owners are a very different market though. Like, this vehicle, it is marketed to a very different market that's not looking for what the Range Rover gives you, so. I guess there's, you know.
Yes, first of all, you can get 22s on a Defender. If you can get 22s on a vehicle.
Yeah, but you can't get Steelys on a Discovery.
That's true. That's a good point. But if you can get 22s on a vehicle, that's a good hint that it's tailored.
Look, the train management is pretty much the same between a Discovery, a Range Rover, an Evoque, a Velar, right?
Not an Evoque or a Velar.
Software. But the hardware is different in a Defender.
Yeah,
right?
But
and that's what makes it.
Suspension apparently is pretty similar to a Discovery.
Right, but it's the hardware.
But that is hardware. Suspension is
more hardware. Like, it's like a Steelys, you know.
But name what else? So, like, the Discovery, you can get with a low range, you can get it with a differential lock, and they all have air suspension, or you can get it with air suspension.
Right,
it's adjustable.
But there's no winch option, I don't think. So you can get a winch.
On Discoveries.
But that was a special one.
You can also get a winch on the new Range Rovers. Just not from the factory.
Fighting against that, right? So the packages you can get for it, the features, right? In a Range Rover with 22s, taking it off-road just seems absolutely silly. I know you can and it will do it, but it's just not, it's just, it's like, I don't know, it's like wearing workout clothes to, right? You can do it, but who'd want to do that? Whereas with this, it actually feels like it belongs off-road, and I think that is a testament to, you know, the design and then all the ability they gave it, and that's why we wanted to test it.
But why does it feel like, I mean, it really... The suspension is pretty similar to the Discovery.
Okay, and this is one of the biggest things. And this is where, if you have not taken the new Defender out for a test drive, go do it, like, right away. Because as soon as you do, and if you've driven Range Rovers or the current Disco, you're going to see instantly why the Defender makes sense for today's Land Rover lineup. When you're driving it, it just feels like it wants to be off-road. Everything about it is just squared off. Like I said on my Instagram, the new Defender is basically like a luxurious or upscale Wrangler. Like, it drives the same way. It's squared. You're sitting in there squared. You have those big, the black things on the hood. It just reminds me so much of what driving a Wrangler is like. It just feels like you want to hop the curb. It just feels like it wants to be off-road. Whereas driving around my Range Rover, it does not feel like that at all. Like, it doesn't at all, but you know it can, and you know it can keep up with the best, and it does it without breaking a sweat. But the Defender does feel like a true off-roader for today's Land Rover lineup. Not comparing it to the past, because that's irrelevant, because it's 2021, we're not comparing things to the past anymore. That doesn't make any sense or do any good. And that was the biggest thing that blew me away, was just how different it drove compared to the rest of the current lineup. And that's another thing. And that's why I've been trying to connect with somebody who owns a Defender locally, so we can go and do a couple off-road trails with their Defender in my Range Rover, and we can actually see, compare apples to apples, which one is actually better off-road, which one does the same test with more ease or struggles a bit more. Because that's one thing I haven't seen any videos on yet. If you know a video, let me know. But I haven't seen anyone actually compare the new Defender to the current Discovery, to the current Range Rover Sport. And those are the videos I want to see, because hell, for 90 grand, I ain't buying a Defender. Pfft, hell no, I'm gonna buy a Range Rover. It just makes way more sense. But for my, you know, I guess for what I want, Defender owners are a very different market though. Like this vehicle, it is marketed to a very different market that's not looking for what the Range Rover gives you, so. I guess there's, you know.
But, yes, first of all, you can get 22s on a Defender. If you can get 22s on a vehicle.
Yeah, but you can't get Steelys on a Discovery.
That's true. That's a good point. But if you can get 22s on a vehicle, that's a good hint that it's tailored. Look,
the train management is pretty much the same between a Discovery, a Range Rover, an Evoque, a Velar, right?
Not an Evoque or a Velar.
Software. But the hardware is different in a Defender.
Yeah,
right?
And
that's what makes it.
Suspension apparently is pretty similar to a Discovery.
Right, but it's the hardware.
But that is hardware. Suspension is
more hardware. Like, it's like a Steelys, you know.
But name what else? So, like, the Discovery. You can get it with a low range, you can get it with a differential lock, and they all have air suspension, or you can get it with air suspension.
Right,
it's adjustable.
But there's no winch option, I don't think. So you can get a winch.
You can get a winch on Discoveries.
But that was a special one.
You can also get a winch on the new Range Rovers. Just not from the factory.
Even the recovery hooks, right, in the X, you can get those.
I think Discovery still has recovery hooks. It still has that central one in the front there.
I don't think it has the two in the back, like the Defender X has.
What the Defender needed to be was a totally different product line than what Land Rover currently makes.
But that's exactly what it is. Why didn't this guy realize that? That's exactly what it is, Tommy. It's a completely different vehicle than what Land Rover currently offers.
That's straight up, it's like
My argument would be that if you don't want to compromises, go get a Discovery or Discovery Sports. The Defender is the heart of the brand. This proves that we're still capable. This proves that we're still out there building vehicles built for the Outback. And I think it should have had coil springs, solid axles, and it should have been like 45 grand, maybe even a convertible top, because that's what the old one was really known for.
Okay, now he does have a point on that. You know, they could have really made a very bare bones base model. Now, were they going to ever go with solid axles and compared to their, you know, independent suspensions now? No, God, no. Land Rover is not going to do something as that ridiculous. It's, no, God, no. They're just not going to build something like that with today's market. But they could have gone with something where they're offering the availability. Like, you can't put anything smaller than, what, 18s on those? Right? You can't go down to 16 or 17 inch rims with really, really fat off-road tires. That's something I know a lot of, you know, enthusiast off-roaders, that's a big complaint that they have. The air suspension, though, I believe you can get it with coil springs. It just comes standard with air suspension. But I'm pretty sure you can get it with coilovers.
I would love to see that Defender. I'm not sure anybody would buy it, but I would love to see it. I think a few hardcore off-roaders would buy it. But I think right now that market is owned by Jeep. And soon Bronco is going to come and try to knock Jeep off. So then you'd have like basically three brands all going for that. And I'm not sure that there's, you know, like at the end of the day, people buy the vehicle because of what they want to use it for, but they keep it because for what they use it for. You see what I'm saying? So you buy this thing because, well, you think, hey, I need to go off-road and it's going to be cool. I'm going to take that overlanding trip across the southwest of America. But the reason you keep it is because it works, you know, when you take your kids to school or when you take your mom to church or when you, you know, drive it to work in a snowstorm. That's why you keep it.
But a ton of people keep Wranglers for a long time.
A ton of people keep Wranglers not just because of that, but because they're ultimately personalizable. And
well, that could be the Defender.
The aftermarket doesn't exist. So a Wrangler, look, you can make a Wrangler into anything you want, right? It's inexpensive. And so
a
Defender will never be inexpensive even in the aftermarket, right? Mm-hmm. The only thing that's inexpensive on the Defender are those rods that lift rods. Those are the only thing. Everything else is, you know, is British expensive. And the Wrangler is like a Harley, right? You can slap about 5,000 different bumpers four bulb tries, you pull it off, put the new one back on. It took the dealership 2 weeks to put on 2 inches on a Defender,
but that's
and it left the vehicle undrivable.
I mean, Dad, you were proving my point.
I'm just saying it's not going to be something customized.
If they had made it basic, if they had made it so that you could customize it, people would. First of all, there's a lot of people out there, I should say a lot of people, there's a good number of people that are looking for an unusual off-roader. So, obviously, Wrangler's totally saturated. Bronco, they're going to sell a ton of them. But there are those people that want to be a little different, that maybe want a little bit more luxury, but still want the off-road.
You know what they're going to buy, really? Or a Cybertruck.
They're not going to buy a Cybertruck, no.
No.
What they would have bought, though, is a solid axle Defender. It's kind of off the wall, a little bit quirky, but it's a solid brand that people know and people want to know about. I think it would have done really, really well. I think by basically making another Discovery, they hurt themselves. And this is the one brand that they have that really is such a strong name
in the
off-road world.
I mean, the way you hurt yourself is by having a vehicle that doesn't work, right? So maybe, I guess if I had, and I'm not one to give advice, but if I had any advice for Land Rover after this experience, I'd be like, you know, you need to go back to basics and you need to figure out, you know, why a brand new vehicle is throwing a check engine light and you know, why that can't be repaired. That just seems like a very basic thing. And, you know, this is why FJs right now are so valuable.
FJ Cruisers?
Yeah, and 4Runners and Tacomas, right? Because
they work.
Because people, there's been like a shift in the zeitgeist that's happened recently. And I don't know if it's because of 2020 or because of, you know, the fact that cars are hard to get now and trucks are hard to get, but people really are looking for vehicles that are reliable. In the past, you know, I think people would be like, I'm going to lease this thing for a couple of years, and if it's reliable or not, I don't care because it's under warranty, and then I'll trade it up for a different one. But now reliability has become, I think, crucial, and even more crucial in the car buying process. And so I would say you need to focus on reliability if you want to be successful. So maybe spend less time worrying about, you know, the $30,000 Defender and more time making sure that, you know, you've crossed your T's and dotted your I's when it comes to reliability.
Okay, no. Why not do both?
Because
make the $35,000 Defender and make it reliable.
Because you only have...
Why not?
Because
they can do it.
The brand's image is tied up right now in its you know, reliability.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that if I were running a company, I would definitely concentrate on.
And I agree. Like, it's paramount. Yeah.
And look, it's a new factory. It's a new vehicle. It's gonna have issues. It just is, right? You build a new factory, you build a new vehicle, and you combine those two in a new country, right? So it's no longer being built in the UK. And you combine those three things, and you end up with obviously some teething issues. And I think we're experiencing that.
All right, well, let us know what you think in the comment section below.
Yeah.
On the new Defender, our issue.
All right, guys, wrapping it up. Let me know what you thought of this. What did you think of their little discussion there? I'd love to know your thoughts in the comments. You know, it's been an interesting journey. They might not be making the video series they want, but they make it a pretty interesting video series. So they're definitely going to be getting... you know, the views and the attention, I think, a lot more with this, because negative news travels a lot further than positive news, even in the car world, right? But till next time, everybody, hit me up in the comments, connect with me on Instagram. Till next time, drive hard.